Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm your host, Stuart Dambrot. We're here with Lina Srivastava talking about transmedia activism. We're going to talk about transmedia activism in the field, as it were. Examples of projects, your projects as well as others.
Yeah.
And so let's start with a couple of projects by others that
Sure.
you feel represent the field.
So I've been watching with interest this one project called 18 Days in Egypt. It's a colleague of mine named Jigar Mehta, who used to be a New York Times video journalist. And he started looking at the concept of telling stories together through video and through social media. He went to Egypt right during the 18 days, during the revolution, and realized that there was all this content that was being created by people who were in Tahrir Square, who were in sort of in the middle of the revolution, and realized that there was a really interesting way to take something like, you know, we have these innovations now of Storify and Cowbird and all these different tools, but how do you then take all of those tools and start telling a story together? If you were in the middle of the revolution, how do you curate all of that content
right,
and then tell
right,
streams
right.
of stories?
How do
right?
you create a property without a script? In essence, right?
To a certain extent, yeah. Originally, I think they were trying to create a full-length documentary, but all the content that's been created, and they have a website called 18daysinegypt.com with the 18 and 1-8, and all the content that's there is so compelling, and it's curated in such a way that I don't even know if the documentary is going to be, the traditional quote-unquote documentary is going to be necessary, because all the stories that lead there, they're leading to a collective memory around what happened during those 18 days, and that story,
right,
those
right.
stories are never going to be lost to a certain extent, which I think I find fascinating. Because a lot of, you know, a lot of the work that I do that's in the context of conflict or genocide, there's always a, you know, sort of this political will to either hide the stories, or there's one party that wants to make sure that those stories don't get told.
Of course. Yeah.
And this is an amazing opportunity to tell those stories and make sure that the world hears those stories. So I'm really interested in that project.
Let me ask a question.
Sure.
It just occurred to me. For example, if that gets turned into a documentary and
yes.
it's web deployed,
yeah.
Are some of the stories that are on the website mm-hmm. would appear in the documentary, I'm assuming?
I'm assuming, yeah.
Because then you could have an interesting transmedia extension where you can place links in the documentary
mm-hmm.
that follow this technology that allows following a link as that object, and say a person, moves through the video
yeah.
landscape, that will always take
yeah.
to the website and the section of the website about that individual or that group.
Well, there's a project that is experimenting with that technique right now called Aura Amba. It's a village in Ethiopia, and the woman who created it is a woman named Paulina Tervo, and she has used something called wirewax technologies, which is basically makes video clickable. And what you can do while you're in the film, it's a short film, but in the film you can click right through to a social action.
Yes,
that's
the kind
of
thing I'm talking about.
Yeah, exactly. And people are experimenting with that right now, and it's a huge opportunity. So that's great.
Very good.
Yeah, and that's where, you know, when you call me a sort of a non-futurist or a non-techno optimist, I'm optimist about technology like that. Right? So when I see technology that can enhance our ability to participate or enhance interaction, I get really excited. So that kind of technology excites me.
Oh, very good. Very good. No promises, but perhaps we can look into doing something with some of the properties we're talking about.
Okay, great.
But no promises. No promises. So that said, the person you just mentioned said something that you relayed in
mm-hmm.
your talk at TEDx 2011 Transmedia,
mm-hmm.
Which was that stories that are told together are stronger. And when I read that, it hit me. And yet I also realized that I wanted to deconstruct what stronger meant
sure.
in that particular context. Was it emotionally stronger? Was it more effective at getting the group message out? How was it in fact stronger in your view?
And again, this is not necessarily a project that I've worked on, so I'm speaking, you know, as an outsider to a certain extent. But stronger means it's all of those things. The beauty of transmedia as a social innovation is that it ensures that we have a number of voices participating in a social action. So you get multiple, you get diverse perspectives, you get local voice. Local voice is much easier to harness and to use to create empathy and to create action in a transmedia platform than it is, right? So when just the statement, group stories told together are stronger, the way I interpret that is that it's stronger because of a number of different voices, a number of different perspectives, a number of different channels that you engage through. So I think groups that, the way they're telling stories, that they're actually telling streams of stories together. And the way I'm looking at some of the platforms that I'm building or helping to build, we're looking at a number of different voices that come in and tell, they might be telling individual stories, but then everybody's telling a story together about a particular issue, and it puts a much more human face on it.
I would imagine this, I may be off on this, but I would imagine that there's something also stronger in its authenticity. Mm-hmm. Rather than it being a formal documentary that's scripted and rehearsed and so on, this is people's reactions, immediate and almost naive and raw, as it were.
Yeah.
And so that's very honest.
Yeah.
And I think that would also bring a lot of strength to it.
There's still a place, you know, in the world, especially in the world of social issue filmmaking, for the long form documentary. And a lot of transmedia platforms still hang themselves. Still, they don't hang themselves. They still rely on a traditional sort of 90-minute, 75-minute kind of documentary as a centerpiece, which is great, which is fine.
Very good, I understand.
But there is an enhanced opportunity through interaction and interactivity. So there's not just the ability to use content that is naive or is raw or is immediate. There is an immediacy to it. It's also much more human in that way. But there's still, to craft a narrative and be true to an aesthetic that one auteur, one author has, there's still a value to that. So I'm not saying
that's
that transmedia
well said.
Will displace that at all.
I see that now. And it does allow, I see now how you're saying that it allows multiple entry points into the narrative. That's also very interesting. Okay, so then you mentioned local voice, and also at the TED Talk, you had mentioned the three key components of transmedia and transmedia activism, local voice being one, and the other two being moving beyond awareness into engagement, and the third is that the use of technology to cross boundaries and borders.
Yeah.
Could you address the latter two?
Sure. Well, the first, I want to actually address the first one for 1 second, just because it's not simply local voice,
right?
Where a lot of people think that in moving towards local voice, there is an inherent criticism of sort of the Western filmmaker or the Western media creator. That's not my position at all. What I'm looking for in terms of local voice is a greater partnership, right? So if it came to a distinction between, you know, sort of the Western voice versus the local voice, whatever local voice means, it could be the Northern voice versus the Southern voice. It could be the privileged voice versus the oppressed voice. It could be any of those dynamics. If it came to a distinction between those, I would always choose sort of the more local or the more, you know, the voice coming out of the oppressed. But with transmedia, you don't have to choose that. There's a greater ability to create partnership, to create real partnerships. And so when we talk about co-creation networks, it's not simply co-creation networks of the people who have access to technology or the privileged. It is also having people who don't always get heard, right? And I'll say something about local voice. One of my least favorite phrases in all of social change is, we're giving voice to the voiceless,
right?
Because from my perspective, nobody's voiceless. Everybody has a voice. Even in the context of the oppressed, people might be repressing their voices. That doesn't mean they don't have voice, and you have to sort of acknowledge that inherent power that everybody has that might be repressed. But what a transmedia platform does is it allows for a number of different voices, and it allows for co-creation and therefore partnership. So that's what I'll say about local voice.
Very good.
About looking at sort of moving beyond awareness, I come out of the nonprofit world and out of social action. I don't come out of media. So when I look at sort of framing transmedia projects or framing media projects, even if they're single platform, I'm looking at moving from awareness, which is necessary. It's an element that you have to have. You can't make change if you're not aware of it, right? So, but a lot of social change media gets stuck either at awareness or my second step, which is engagement. People get they fall in love with the technology, or they fall in love with sort of the awareness raising into engaging your audience. But then you have to bridge that gap into action. And that's where I'm looking. So I'm looking at awareness to engagement to action to change. That's my sort of spectrum. And so I'm looking at bridging the gap. All the work that I do and that my colleagues do is in the engagement realm, right? If we're creating assets, we're creating stories, and we're sending stories out into the world, and we're inviting people into the world. That's all engagement to a certain extent. But how do you flip that? How do you bridge that gap to action? And that's my pain point, right? That's where I'm sort of looking at that arrow and trying to figure out how you get all of this energy and change it into what is sort of respectful, resonant, relevant action to a local community.
And so that would seem to flow very quickly into the last point, I think, about using the technology we're speaking of to cross those boundaries and borders, and by doing so, step into an action of sorts.
Right. And so what you're trying to do, what the ultimate platform, ultimate point of a transmedia platform for social action is to actually create measurable change to a certain extent, right? So how do you do that? You don't do that by simply making a film. That's not going to work, right? So how do you then take a transmedia platform, make sort of use the technology and use the narrative, right? Technology only goes so far to a certain extent. Mm. How are you telling the story? And what are your social action goals? How do you pair those? And then how do you use the technology to sort of get to action and then get to change?
So it creates a sense of ownership through the participation. I'm paraphrasing it, but in a sense, because it seems to me that once the individuals who are engaged feel a sense of ownership over the outcome, and then a channel is provided for them to take action, they'd be much more predisposed to taking that action, I would imagine.
So IDEO.org actually just released its, they released their human-centered design toolkit, I think it was 2 years ago now, and they just launched their storytelling platform. They are now, out of the toolkit, they're now curating stories that are coming from the field of people who've used that toolkit.
Oh, that's fascinating.
So that's a storytelling platform that they're building that harnesses local voice and talks about the change that the technologies that they've built, where, you know, some of it is actual technology, some of it is just conversation.
Sure.
But how is that enhanced and how is that aided in sort of local development, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm doing something sort of similar right now with the World Bank. I'm working with the World Bank right now to figure out how you use transmedia and transmedia principles to look at leadership in global development. I've done that with UNESCO. So on the one hand, where I look at transmedia as an interesting principle for extending narrative, like a traditional narrative, like films or music, how you extend those, I'm also looking at on the sort of aid and development institutional side. Like, how do you use those principles to break down those institutional barriers? Or those discipline barriers, right? So if mm-hmm. I'm a designer, how do I then talk to a global development person, and how do I talk to an NGO person on the ground using narrative?
So it's right. It's tapped completely into the zeitgeist of cross-functionality and interdisciplinary efforts that are in academia, in science, and every walk of life.
Exactly. And how do you use narrative? Because the one thing that we all share as humans is narrative, right, or storytelling, and how do you use storytelling to help sort of create those bridges between disciplines, and then also how do you use those to create create collaboration between people who are regionally or ethnically or religiously sort of diverse?
Well, very good. Thank you so much.